My name is Jason Shepard, and I'm the chair of the Cobb County Republican Party. Thank you. I appreciate you all coming out on a beautiful Saturday morning. I hope some of you will stick around to help us go door to door for Kay Kilpatrick and Karen Handel. And there's Kay. I'd also like to introduce your executive officers. My first vice chair, Hannah Buxton. If you have a question that you'd like to submit for consideration to the forum, see my second vice chair, Michael Davis. He'll give you an index card. Raise your hand and he'll come find you. Mr. Gill, I already have your questions. Some of you also submitted them on Facebook, so we also got those to our moderator. And thank you very much for that. Our third vice chair, Deborah Williams. Secretary John Hightower. Treasurer Bill Hadley. Still making take the money outside. And Assistant Treasurer Jim Boyd right there. I will also like to recognize the elected officials who are in the room. Only three of you signed the sheet, so if I miss you, please stand up and introduce and let me know you're here as well. But the ones who signed in, State Representative Ed Setzler. Cobb County Commission Chairman Mike Boyce. State Representative Bert Reeves. I saw Sam Teasley come in as well. And State Senator Hunter Hill. He's looking for a new job, if you haven't heard. But he'll talk a little bit more about that. Did I miss any elected officials? Anyone? Okay, moving on. I would actually like to call up State Representative Sam Teasley for the prayer. And afterwards, State Senator Hunter Hill for the pledge.
Good morning. Can you join me in prayer? God, we love you. And we thank you for this morning. We thank you. It is indeed a beautiful morning and a day that you've made. We ask for your blessing on this time that we have together. We ask you for your blessing on the food that many of us have already eaten. Some will here in a few minutes. But more than that, we ask for your blessing on our country. We ask that you give our leaders wisdom. They will follow your word. Again, we thank you for all the wonderful things you've done. We again ask for your blessing on today's meeting. It's Christ's name of prayer.
Good morning. You already stood up, so please join me as we honor our flag and our country.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation under God,
towards the end, but we've got some candidates who are very busy. They're trying to win right now. Kay Kilpatrick, whose election is a week from Tuesday. Early voting in Cobb County starts on Monday. It's only a week of early voting. So we really need everyone's help. Like I said, if you can walk this weekend or next weekend, we are going to be having a very big event next weekend, the barbecue. If you come walk in the morning, we'll feed you barbecue lunch. If you plan to walk in the afternoon, we'll feed you lunch and send you out. So look for your email about that. If not, all of you, just make the note right now to show up next Saturday, anytime between 10 a.m. and 6 p.m. If you can't walk, we got phone calls, and you can help us make phone calls, but we got to get out the vote. for Kay and Karen, especially for Kay right now because it's critical, and most people don't understand that there's two election dates. So we're saying it's Kay in May, and Karen will handle June. So Kay, can you come and say a few words?
To be among friends, because not everybody out there is my friend right now. There's a lot of shenanigans going on with the opposition, if you will, and it's been a new experience since I'm not previously in politics. So one thing that is very clear is that there's a very clear line of demarcation between me and my very super liberal opponent. So what we need to do is be sure that the word is out there. May 16th is the date. Early voting starts Monday. It's the 8th through the 12th. So you guys know where I'm coming from. You've heard me speak before. I'm not going to take a lot of your time. But if you could each contact anybody that you know in East Cobb and get them to turn out either early or on May 16th, that would really help me a lot. And we need to keep this seat because that's going to help Ms. Karen handle right here. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Kay. And next I'd like to ask the person who is going to basically let the Democratic Party waste over $20 million. Someone who doesn't even live in the district. Again, someone who's lived in the district as long as I've lived in Georgia, which has been more than 25 years. I went to high school in the 6th District. My first job out of college was working for Newt Gingrich in the 6th District, not up in D.C. And so this, I live in the 11th District now, but this is personal to me. And this is the person who's going to keep it Republican, keep it red, Karen Handel.
Every person in this room for the support and friendship. It was certainly a spirited primary, but I want you to know that all of us are united and we are ready to go. We know what we need to do for June 20th, and we all have to get out and work hard. And I want to recognize Daryl as our new 6th District Chairman, who's going to help us make sure that we do what we have to do, not just here in Cobb, but election in May, and make no mistake about it, what happens in Kay's race will affect what happens on June 20th, so we have to work very, very hard coming into May 16th. We can't let up. We have to keep going into June 20th. It is 45 days, y'all, where we have to have pedal to the metal for Kay and then for me in the 6th. We have a lot at stake here, and I will tell you, the Democrats, they are pouring the money in. Steve told me on the way over this morning that it's now official. This is officially the most expensive congressional race in the history. Wow. So that is a lot of money. We're opening our East Cobb office tomorrow afternoon. It's over by Lassiter High. We've got some flyers on the table that we'll hand out. I hope you can all join us. But most importantly, let's stay focused. Let's get Kay elected on May 16th. And then on June 20th, what are we going to do? We're going to kick some ass off. Let's do it. God bless you.
Thank you, Kay. And there's more bacon if anyone wants bacon.
Everything's better with bacon.
Exactly.
Here's where the pork is.
And real quickly, I'd like to recognize Hunter Hill again to come up here and say a few words about trying to get out the vote in these races. By the way, if you live east of I-75, or you know someone who lives east of I-75 in Cobb, more than likely, they're voters in both Kay's district and Karen's district. So if they're not political, they don't come to breakfasts like this, you can be a big help. And a lot of you are already being a big help trying to get out the message. But we do need more people, especially this critical last week. Hunter Hill, will you please come up?
Well,
first of all, it's great to be with y'all. I'm going to be brief. I can't wait to hear from the candidates for our state GOP. But y'all, this is all important. It's extremely important for when I was in the Senate this term, as Judson left to go run for Congress, we lost a senator. And as a result of that, we lost critical votes to be able to do things like constitutional amendments because we lost a key Republican. So replacing Judson immediately is very important. We've got to get Kay in there. We've got to have people getting out there and working because of the confusion that's been brought up about May 16th versus June 20th. So call your friends, call your neighbors, make sure we get them to the polls. If our voters come, we will win. It's that simple. So we've got to get them out there. We've got to get Karen up in Congress. The great thing that's so exciting about this whole new wave of leadership with Donald Trump is that we have a chance to move the needle in Washington. I'd always believed that the only way to change Washington was from the state level first, for Georgia to have strong conservative leadership. We actually can do it now from Washington, but we gotta have all of our seats filled. We gotta have Karen back up in Washington to fill the seat that Tom left. So it's very important. This is not a shoe-in because of the amount of money. We have to work. We can't leave one voter on the sideline. So call your friends, call your family. You've got to do whatever you can. So I don't live in the sixth. Yes?
Can people who newly register this week vote for Kay?
I don't know the answer to that.
No.
I don't think so.
I think
that we have a 30-day limit. Yeah, so last thing I want to say is we've got to get Karen elected. And as many of you know, I have launched a candidacy for governor. And the main reason I have it's going to be a long year, but we are going to work our tails off. We're going to pursue this with tenacity and humility, and we're going to earn it every day. And the reason is because we can't continue to wait for true conservative leadership. We've got to move the needle in Georgia for our values, and that's what I'm going to represent. Obviously, over the course of the year, I'm going to be casting that vision every day to the voters of this state, and we're going to earn it every day. So if you have any questions about where I stand on the issues and what is my vision for Georgia, I look forward to meeting with you personally to talk about that. I know that I'm going to get an opportunity to speak to the entire Cobb GOP in August. But I'm grateful to be from Cobb and to be a part of this delegation for many years. And I'm looking forward to hearing the candidates. Thank you very much.
I talked to Phil Daniel, who's excellently serving us on the Cobb County Board of Elections. He's actually the appointment from the legislative delegation.
He's the chairman of the board.
And he's chairman of the board. And he handed me this morning. He actually sent out an email that I got a couple days ago that there's approximately 20,000 voter registrations in Cobb County that will be affected by this ruling. In other words, over 20,000 new voters added to the rolls. However, those voter applications will not be processed in time for Senate District 32 race. In fact, the order is that they will be held until after that vote is certified. However, that kind of tells you what we're dealing with. 20,000 plus new registered voters for the 6th Congressional District. And, the Board of Elections probably could use some temporary help if you need a part-time job going through all that. Right, Phil? Yep, okay. So go to cobbelections.org. But, that's what we're facing here, folks. That's why we can't take anything for granted this time. That we need people who will wave signs, that we'll need people who will knock on doors, and we'll need people to make phone calls. Not only to tell them about the election, but to remind our voters exactly how important this is.
Jason, do you know if we're appealing that?
I don't know. Are we appealing it?
I haven't heard of any.
We haven't heard. Okay.
Time is a problem with that.
Right.
That
is. So
we just need to get more Republicans registered.
We just need, yes. So, and that's going to be part of the effort as well. We now have the open window, and we can take advantage of it too. So also, we have a couple of breakfast sponsors I want to recognized. Breakfast sponsors, sponsorship is $100. We limit it to four for both time constraints and space constraints because the sponsor gets two tickets. Once again, we have four breakfast sponsors I'd like to call up. First, Anthony Scott Hobbs, if he wants to take 2 minutes to say something. Or
I'm just going to say good morning. It's exciting to be a Cobb County Republican, isn't it?
Yeah!
Let's stick with Jesus. It's exciting, isn't it? Huh? Good morning, everybody.
Thank you.
Next, Frank Molesky. Oh.
I say ditto with Anthony said.
Tim Adderholt. Is he here? I haven't seen him this morning. He's sick. So he may be able to say something. I'll let him say something in August, which our next breakfast will be in August because of the state convention and the 4th of July. And also, I guess the last one is Michael McNeely.
Hey, Michael.
Well, obviously, you're going to be hearing a lot from me and the other candidates here in a few moments. But I'm proud to be here with you. I'm proud to serve in the grassroots with you, and I'm looking forward to Karen's victory, as well as many, and Ms. Kilpatrick, many more in the coming years. We've got a lot of work to do, and I'm looking forward to working with you. Thank you for all that you do here.
And with that, the part of the program we've all been waiting for, the seal to fall down. I'd like to call up the candidates to come up and take their seats. Everyone has their name tag, and basically everyone's in alphabetical order. With Alex Johnson here and Mike Welsh on this end. And also I'd like to introduce our moderator for today. If you listen to WSB radio in the morning on the way home, or sorry, the way to work, Scott Slade's voice is very familiar to you. Scott is the host of Atlanta Morning News on WSB every morning. It helps keep the sanity for those of us who have to fight the traffic every day. In fact, a couple days ago, I shot him a text message and said, my mantra in the morning was Serenity Now, for those of you who are Seinfeld fans. So, Scott Slade is a multiple Marconi Award winner. He's in the Radio Hall of Fame. And it's an honor and pleasure to have him here with us this morning to moderate this event. Mr. Scott Slade, thank you very much.
Greetings from the media. The first impression that I had was finding a parking space in this place. So one of the impressions I'm taking back is there is no lack of enthusiasm among the Cobb GOP. We appreciate doing that, walking in the door. All right, the most important question I have for our Cobb chairman is, what time do you want to be done?
We'll be done by about 9:50.
You have a whole hour. Okay, terrific. Well, here are the rules, and I understand each of the candidates have agreed to these rules. Is that right?
They haven't voiced any objections.
Okay, good. Each candidate has 2 minutes to introduce themselves. They're seated alphabetically, but I'll be rotating the starting order for the questions. Questions provided both by me, the moderator, I don't know any of these gentlemen personally, from our audience, questions solicited online via the audience today. I've combined some questions to save time because we won't be able to get to all of them. No questions in advance to any of the candidates. Each candidate has 1 minute to answer each question. And it's not a debate, which means that we won't have back and forth between them unless one candidate brings up another in an attack. And in that case, they'll have 30 seconds to respond. There will be no rebuttal to the response. No responses will be allowed to closing statements. Each candidate will be given 2 minutes for closing statements. And closing statements, as well as the opening statements, will be in alphabetical order by last name. Gentlemen, are we okay with all that?
Sure.
All right. Paper is Carolyn Garcia right there.
Carolyn, where are you? Thank you very much. Now, I just need you to yell out time. Oh, you'll be doing that. Very good. Okay, thanks very much. That helps. Okay, so 2 minutes for openings and closings and 1 minute responses to the questions. And gentlemen, you'll just have to pass the microphone back and forth. So if it's okay with you, I'll start with first and last name, then proceed to first name because it's easier. We're all friends. Alex Johnson, would you please grab the microphone?
This thing worked out, so I'll just talk right now. I'm Alex Johnson. I'm running for chairman of the state party. Glad to be here again after last month. Thank you. This is one of the biggest GOP gatherings in the state, and this is a testament to the great leadership here in Cobb County and all the work you're all doing. I appreciate being here. I'm running for chairman of the state party. I think we need to focus on keep getting more people involved in the party. So meetings like this happen in every county around the state. I've been doing it. I've been leading the GRA for the past year and a half, and trying to get more people involved. Many of you met me when I was up here at the Cobb for Trump volunteer group, showing people how to be involved in the party and in the delegate selection process over a year ago. I've been involved way before that, since 2009. I've been pushing the idea that we need more people involved, more people knowing about our party, so that way we get more Republicans elected. So we can help out Karen, we can help out Kay, we can help all the Republicans around the state by having a strong infrastructure. So with that, I'm Alex Johnson. You can find all of my past 4 years of things I've been putting out, keeping people informed at advancethegop.com, and I'd appreciate your vote in Augusta. Thank you.
Well, good morning, everyone.
Good morning.
Glad to be here with you. A little bit about me. My name, again, is Michael McNeely. I'm a Georgia native from a little town called Renz, Georgia. I grew up there with my mother and father, graduated college from Georgia Southern University with a degree in criminal justice. I served as a police officer for 14 years in Metro Atlanta. Served in the Georgia Army National Guard, and proud to tell you I'm an Eagle Scout. And currently serve as executive with juvenile justice. So I've been very proud of that service over the years. And also in the party. I've been involved in the party, part of the grassroots for many years. First getting involved with Governor Sonny Perdue's reelect and being a volunteer of the week in that campaign. And working in my county party over the years, waving signs, going door to door, making phone calls on behalf of our candidates, talking to as many audiences as I could about our principles and how they apply to everyone's lives. And we should never cede ground to any group, any person, but boldly talk about our principles, boldly talk about how our principles have made this country great and will make it great again. I ask for your vote to become the next chairman, and understand that whoever you support in this race, understand that that person cannot do the work alone. There is no man or woman that's an island unto themselves. Anybody that's ever done anything great has not done it alone. And if the things that we can and will do, we'll do it together. Thank you for what you do here, and I look forward to continuing the conversation. It's John Watson, 2 minutes, please.
Good morning.
Good morning. Good morning.
Long time since Vittles. Anybody remember Vittles way back when? Good gracious, Michael Opitz. The old timers coming out in that. Indeed, my name is John Watson. I am a candidate for chairman of the Georgia Republican Party. Quick biography, my wife and I, Kimberly, my wife Kimberly and I and our two girls are here in Cobb County. I began my political career as the finance director for Congressman Bob Barr, left Congressman Barr, had the opportunity of working at the Georgia Republican Party again as the finance director, had the best opportunity there, which was to meet my wife and of now almost 20 years in December. Moved on from that point in time and had the honor of my life, which was working for then a candidate from Middle Georgia by the name of Sonny, was Sonny's chief political consultant and later chief of staff, working on behalf of the citizens of this great state and seeing him safely through re-election. Last comment about resume, I will say this, I had the high honor of being the volunteer campaign co-chair for David Perdue. And thank you to each and every person in this room for supporting David. For chairman of the Georgia Republican Party because the party that I love, the party that I've been involved with for 25 years, is at a crossroads. We are financially broke, we are mired in litigation, and most importantly, the grassroots and the party, the faithful conservatives and grassroots volunteers of this party feel disconnected, disenchanted, not communicated with, nor embraced. It is time for a chairman with the time, the daily time, a sense of urgency, political experience, a battlefield general who takes no time, day one, to get on the job, to raise the resources as a professional, and to win in 2018 to secure the next governor. Thank you.
And Michael Welsh, 2 minutes, please.
Good morning. How many of y'all are seeing me for the very first time? That's what I thought. You see, I'm the outsider. I'm the guy that's been over in the trenches of the 12th district for the last several years, turning the state red. Because we took the last Blue Dog Democrat out. We got rid of John Barrow when everybody said it couldn't be done. We found a way to do it. I'm the guy that thinks kind of differently because I've got a background in business. I have a master's degree in accounting from UGA and a bachelor's degree from UGA in finance. I've been married to my lovely bride, Susie, for almost 35 years. In fact, our 35th wedding anniversary is the Monday after the state convention. So I especially need your prayers, because you know I've not done a lot of planning for that event. So I need your prayers on that. But I have come up with a simple 4-point plan. It's on my push card, it's on our website, to drive us forward as a party. Number one, we have to communicate a clear vision to unify the party. Number two, we have to build the digital infrastructure that we need to be able to turn Cobb and Gwinnett red again. Number three, we have to make sure that all the 2016 voters that showed up for the very first time stay with us for generations to come through coalition building. And number four, we have to retire the debt and provide sufficient cash reserves for the 2020 presidential election and the 2018 constitutional elections. Under my leadership, I believe that we can pull this all off, and I look forward to working with you. And I'm Mike Welsh, MikeWelshForGA.com, and I ask for your vote June 3rd in Augusta.
Thank you. Question one, each candidate has 1 minute to answer. The Georgia Republican Party has gotten some heat for the way the 6th District primary was handled.
Yeah.
A last-minute get-out-the-vote effort by the Congressional Leadership Fund, the National Republican Congressional Committee, and President Trump himself is getting some of the credit for preventing Democrat John Ossoff from going over the top with 50% of the vote. We had 11 Republicans sniping at each other and demoralizing the base, 11 candidates splitting the vote. What would you have done differently to achieve a better outcome in the primary? And we will begin with Michael McNeely and then go down the panel. Michael, you have 1 minute. What would you have done differently?
Well, I think everything's about relationships. And so we have to have a relationship with our elected officials and with all the entities involved in the Republican Party, the RNC, the congressional organizations and others, and talk about strategy in and out of election cycles. So if we're doing that 365 days a year and we get to a point where we have an open seat like this, then we will have an opportunity to have a foundation in place to be successful in winning. Now, what we can't do, you know, the party's role is not to, you know, choose winners and losers in a primary. But if we're messaging properly, if we're engaging all communities all year long, then when we get to a point where we've got a contested race like this, people have already heard from us, and then we work together around one candidate to be successful in it.
Thank you. Same question to John Watson. What would you have done differently in the campaign leading up to the 6th District primary?
Folks, the reality is this. Look across this room. Is there a Republican that thinks that they shouldn't have an opportunity to run for office if they choose? Absolutely not. The fact of the matter is, we had a highly contested process, a jungle primary, as it's officially called, that had men and women in it that determined that they, in a free country, had the most to offer for our country. Could there be moments in time when we said to candidates, you know what, there's not a reservoir of support there for you, there's not enough resources for you? Yes, but at the end of the day, we are all benefited by as many Republicans running and holding their hands up and saying, I've got a better idea.
Most importantly, and as important to all those folks, we must all come together, regardless of the numbers of people that are in a primary, lay down your swords, pick up your shield, and move forward with the elected official of our primary.
Michael Welsh, same question to you. What would you have done differently in the 6th District primary?
Well, first of all, you got to look at why we got there, and that's because we, as the Republican Party of Georgia, have a rule that says the party has to sit out when there are two or more running for an election. So we made that decision, whether we like it or not. But first and secondly, I reject the premise. Was it terrible? No. We won. Shouldn't everybody have a chance to choose who they want to represent them? They should. And we should support that from the very beginning. The only perfect candidate for each person is themselves. And they should all encourage their friends and those folks that have like minds and views to run. The more people we have running in the long run, the better off we are. Because people will certainly find the time to do the things to step out and stand out, and we should support them.
Thanks, Mike. I'll ask the same question, sir.
The main thing that needs to be done differently is to stop the current cycle on the state GOP level of just thinking we only need to worry about raising and spending money in the general election. That doesn't work. I've been trying to change that from the last time I ran 2 years ago and four years before now too. The important thing is to have a party that's operating 365 days out of the year on the state level. Not just raising money for the general, but actually getting people involved and getting an infrastructure in place year-round, people knowing how our principles help their lives. Because if we get more people empowered and engaged in the party, then it doesn't matter how many Republicans are running for office, because we'll have 60, 70, 80% of the vote, and we won't have to worry about someone like Ossoff coming around, and he's gonna lose, but we need bigger margins. So in the end, it's about being that infrastructure by working year-round, not just focusing on the money and the consultants.
Sure. Commitment question that was submitted. There are two special elections in Cobb County, one for Senate on the May 16th, Congressional District 6, obviously June 20th. What have you personally done to recruit and direct volunteers to those two races? And rotating the starting order, let's begin with John Watson. What have you personally done?
Ladies and gentlemen, I enjoyed making phone calls on behalf of Karen Handel and the Fulton County Republican Party headquarters. Enjoyed that process, brought volunteers to it. In terms of Ms. Kay, the reality is, folks, I'm always serially driving resources and supporters to both of those processes. Let's talk about why the question was asked. The question is, what is your commitment to the grassroots of this party? And the fact of the matter is, folks, over 25 years of my life, blood, sweat, and tears, I've dedicated my heart and soul to this party through resources, through running campaigns, and engaging with each and every folks, 159 counties, through this process. I will bring that dedication on a daily basis for Ms. Kay, for Ms. Karen, for anyone that holds their hand up to be a Republican. After the primary process is clear, you will have no greater champion, period, serially, having elected, helped elect people like the men and women that are in this room as members of the General Assembly. Thank you.
And to Michael Welsh, what have you personally done to recruit and direct volunteers to these two races that we have on the table?
Well, you know, they say the best way to determine a leader is whether they try to push the string or pull it. And I'm a pull kind of guy, so that means the first person you're going to see calling is me. That's how we won in the 12th, and that's how I've done it up here. I've driven all the 2.5 hours up to this location and over to the Fulton location to phone bank for Karen. And in the 12th district, we put out the word in 12th district. Now, in some cases, that's a 5-hour drive to get up here. We brought 20, how many names did we give you, Darryl? 15 names that I gave to Darryl to make sure that he had support from the 12th district.
If I ask the question, can you pass the microphone down, please? Your personal involvement.
Well, I've been doing exactly what I just said that was important for the party. I've been getting people engaged for the past year and a half. The Republican Assemblies, the Cobb County Republican Assembly in particular, When I became chairman of the Georgia Republican Assembly, we had 6 members statewide. Now we have over 170 paid members. We have a local chapter here in Cobb County with what? Nathaniel's one of the leaders. How many? 40, 50 people? Yeah, that's what's going on. Those people are all engaged in the party now that may not have been otherwise, making sure of supporting Karen Handel and Kate Kilpatrick. Then you look at the fact that the Advance the GOP newsletters, those have been going out statewide, informing people not just in this area but around the state how to get involved in those campaigns. We need an infrastructure. One person, that's very important, getting out, making phone calls, knocking on doors, but we need to replicate that. And the state GOP's obligation is to bring people in so that the leaders in this room can train them, lead them, and get more people knocking on doors, making the phone calls, and spreading the truth of our principles.
Yeah, doing the fundamentals of being a grassroots Republican, making those phone calls, making the personal contact, because we can never cede ground to the Democrats. We can never let go of our intensity in making sure that we're doing that, and making sure people know about the other opportunities around the state, because as you all know, there's been support for our candidates around the state and opportunities to make those calls and to spread that message, and we have to continue doing that. We have to make sure that in any race, that we are communicating who our candidates are, what they believe, and why it's important for us to win. I think one of the ways to do that is return to having a grassroots newsletter so that we have better coordination about our candidates.
Next question. All right, we have a good question. To the issue of involvement here, you hear an awful lot about Democrat voter registration drives, but not so much for Republicans. Next question is, how will you take advantage for this window, this new window, to register voters for the runoff between now and May 21st? How should the Georgia GOP take advantage of that window to register Republican voters? Michael Welsh, we'll begin with you, please.
I would start with the things that make the most sense. It's digital. So we take the map of all the households in the 6th district, and we find out, overlay that with all the registered voters and find out the houses that are not registered. And then we go hit those exact homes asking them what they're, the easy thing to do is start off with a petition that says, do you support certain Republican principles? If they say yes, you register them as a Republican. And then you find the way to get them engaged. With the Secretary of State's website, you can register them with your cell phone right there at the time. So technology can get us there very quickly.
Thank you. Johnson, taking advantage of the windows to register voters.
Well, what the state GOP needs to be doing is engaging more people and getting them out, getting more people involved. 2 million people voted for Donald Trump in the last presidential election. Less than 1% are currently involved in the state GOP. That's where the problem is, because how are we going to register voters without more people knowing the state GOP exists and are engaged with it to actually go out and get that work done? We focus so much on the money in the political industry that we haven't been focused on building an infrastructure to take advantage of the registration deadlines. I mean, we have a gap now, so we need to be out getting more people involved, but ultimately it's about having the infrastructure to make that happen. And right now, the state GOP, the local counties are doing a great job, but the state level doesn't have that type of impact, and that's what we need. We need to be putting out radio ads, TV, having people going out door to door, doing online advertising. That's how we take advantage of things like that.
Well, you've got to communicate our principles, but also how they are applied in legislation. We've had so many successes as Republicans, but how often do you hear about those successes and make sure that the voters hear about those successes? So when we talk about the differences between Republicans and Democrats, we should not be attacking an individual, but attacking the liberal ideas that is bringing our country down. And Donald Trump has been willing to articulate what he believes and what we believe without being ashamed, without being passive about it. We have to do that, connect our principles to the policies, and target the voters that we need to get to come to the polls for Republicans.
A functioning state party, if we had one, would be registering voters all year long. We don't start the process leading up to the tail end of a campaign. If we had a functioning state party, we would indeed have the resources that absolutely are necessary to make certain that we are putting out the information, putting out the applications, walking the walk on a daily basis, 365, such that regardless of what judges say through the process, our folks are in the queue, we've made the ask, and we win.
We have another question here, a different question, and we'll start with Alex Johnson in order. If you're asked what the Republican Party stands for, what will you say, and what does it mean to be a Georgia Republican?
We stand for individual rights. We stand for limited government. We stand for traditional values. Those are the things we stand for, our platform. That's what it comes down to. As chairman, my personal viewpoint of the party isn't what's critical, it's yours. My job is to make sure that the resolutions you pass, the platform that we all agree on, and the things that all of you believe in are reflected in that. So all of you know how to get resolutions submitted, how to have your voice heard, how to get the word out. Because ultimately, what I'll be telling people is that we believe in these principles that you all want enacted in the typical ones that are about individual rights and freedoms, and that way we show people how they help lives. Because that's a critical thing. Donald Trump won because he talked about how what he was going to do was going to help people's lives, get them jobs, do things to help them individually in their lives. That's what the party needs to be doing year-round, talking to people, letting them know how our philosophy makes life better for them and how our elected officials are doing a good job where they are.
Michael McNeely, what it means to be a Georgia Republican?
It means being a true conservative. Now, we've got some diversity amongst our group, but for me, I'm both a fiscal and a social conservative. And I mentioned it in the other comment about Donald Trump being willing to talk to people very plainly about what he believes and the importance of securing our borders and making sure that taxes are lower for everyone. We had an issue of school choice here in Georgia, a statewide initiative, and it passed on the ballot in a bipartisan fashion because we all understand the importance of children being able to have the best educational opportunity possible. We have to talk plainly about what we believe. We have to do it often, and we have to do it in all communities. When Barack Obama won election, they kept people on the ground between his first winning and the reelect. We have to engage at all times, and it takes all of us from the precinct level on up, articulating our principles, not being afraid, drawing a line in the sand when something's wrong, and sometimes that will mean even challenging our fellow Republicans, but willing to stand on those things, because if you don't stand on our principles, then what do we have? If you don't stand for something, you'll fall for anything.
That's right, thank you. Georgia Republican.
Y'all should let Michael keep going. He was on a riff. I liked it. We are an ideological family, folks, that is, and we are bonded by components of, first and foremost, adherence to our Constitution, the principles of liberty, the principles of limited government, the things that make our lives better as compared to our political opponents. We are a family at times that likes to squabble like the Dickens. But the reality is that makes us all better. It gets out our differences and makes us more thoughtful in our arguments. Our family, though, at times, folks, would rather have arguments in the side yard versus having them inside of the kitchen or in our family rooms. And I would say this to all of us, as we prepare for 2018 and the critical election ahead, we must be prepared to have our arguments, but indeed have those in the confines of our homes, because the only folks in the side yard that benefit by our arguments out loud are our Democratic opponents.
Michael Welsh, what it means to be a Georgia Republican, what the parties you stand for?
The simple fact that you're asking that question indicates why point number one on my plan is so important. We have to have a vision that unites us all. And that vision is who we are and what we stand for. For me, it's very simple. It goes back to the founding of this country. Life. Without life, there is no purpose. There is no reason for existence. Liberty. Because life without liberty is slavery and tyranny. And who wants that? None of us. And the one that we've forgotten and we have totally left off the table, the pursuit of happiness. How do we make our country, our community, our state better for our children. We've totally forgotten that. But we can rally folks around ourselves and inspire people to do better and better each and every day if it's clearly communicated.
All right, thank you very much. Now, there's some issue questions you may find have the character of a litmus test. Michael McNeely, we'll start with you. How do you feel about supporting the Planned Parenthood organization, and what should the Georgia GOP's position be?
Well, that's the easy one. We don't need to support Planned Parenthood. We need to stand tall against that type of nonsense. We need another organization. I've taken principled stances on a number of issues, religious liberty legislation, for example. And we have to, again, as I said before, draw a line in the sand and say we're not going to have taxpayer dollars fund an organization that goes against the life of our unborn.
That's right.
Your position on the supporting Planned Parenthood, please.
Planned Parenthood deserves no federal funding or dollars from taxpayers, period.
Michael Welsh, your position on the Planned Parenthood issue.
Planned Parenthood should be defunded at all levels in any place that we can. There's a young man that made a very vivid photography effort about what goes on, the truth behind what goes on in that organization. And one of the gentlemen that was behind him is from Augusta, and we need to support organizations like that that will call out the lies that are being brought upon us at all levels, that it's about women's health. It is not. It is about money and taking money from the least of us, and we must stop it.
And Alex Johnson.
There should be no taxpayer funding or any support for an organization that supports the killing of unborn children. That's appalling, and the idea that exists is terrible and should not be supported ever. The other part of it is that why is it that we need to be fighting the fact that they keep saying that it's about women's health?
Yes.
Obviously, abortions are not about women's health. That's killing women. So we shouldn't be doing that. We should, like, if we're going to be supporting this, and the Republican Party needs to take a clear stand that we all support women's health, yes, and we'll support organizations that support women's health that don't kill babies, right, that don't support abortion. That's what we need to be doing, and not just coalescing and giving in to the Democratic viewpoint that we don't care about women's health. The state Republican Party needs to be standing for the fact that we support women. We support health, but we don't support abortion. We do not support that. We are pro-life.
Another issue that will certainly be coming up from time to time, religious liberty. What should be the Georgia GOP's position on the religious liberty issue? And John Watson, we'll start with you, please.
I support Senator Harbin's bill in the past legislative session that would have closed the coverage gap associated with the state of Georgia and would become a mere image of the federal statute associated with religious liberty. But let's also have an honest discussion with each other, folks. There are degrees of difference on this issue. And we have to acknowledge and understand that in the big tent that must be the state party moving forward, that we must have room for all levels of discernment. I am not for anything in state statute that would intend or create discrimination. I do, however, fully support the closing of the gap of the loophole that again would create a mirror image of the federal statute protecting religious liberty fundamentally and as supportive of President Trump and his initiative and vote of this and executive order of this last week that enables religious institutions to not hide from the IRS and shield their feelings to their congregants.
Michael, what should the Georgia GOP's position be on religious liberty?
Well, I got to ask this question when it first came up when I was chairman of the Resolutions Committee, and a reporter asked me, he says, how do you feel about this controversial issue? And I said, why do you say it's controversial? 11 of the 14 congressional districts passed it. That seems like an overwhelming majority to me. And it is an overwhelming majority for us. We should have no gap between the federal and the state level. But I will tell you, it's become a dog whistle for the left, and they are using it as a way to bully young business owners into being forced to choose between their livelihood and their religious beliefs. And we've got to find a way to stop that. I'm not sure exactly how we do it, but we've got to find a way to stop that. Every single American should have an opportunity to make a living without having to choose between the two.
Yeah. Okay, Alex Johnson, the religious liberty issue, please.
Yeah, the state party has already taken a stance on religious liberty through the resolutions that have been passed over the previous years. Sadly, a lot of those haven't been published anywhere, even though they were supposed to be. So that's the first step, is making sure that everyone knows what the state party stands for when our resolutions pass, especially when all of you, who are leaders of the party, take the time to fight for the resolutions, debate them, get them passed, and then explicitly say they're supposed to be published on the website and sent to elected officials. That actually needs to happen. And then the state party needs to be sure to be out there arguing why it matters. Like, if we're going to be a party in favor of religious liberty, we can't just say it and then do nothing. We need to actually have a state party that has the resources and manpower and the vision to let people know how that protects people's individual rights, how that keeps all religions safe and free and keeps all people safe and free and isn't discriminatory. We need to be out there doing that as a state party so that it's not just during the during the session that it comes up.
Thank you, Alex. Position on religious liberty.
Yeah, well, I mentioned this earlier. I took a very public stance in support of religious liberty legislation. I think it is fundamental to who we are as Republicans. It's fundamental to who we are as Americans. And the part of the founding of our nation was to ensure that the big hand of government, or in that case, the king, did not interfere with our beliefs as individuals. And so I think that we have to support that type of legislation. And where we disagree, we can respectfully disagree, but stand firm and show why it's important that all people, regardless of their religious background, have an opportunity to be free. That's what we're about, and that's what the party needs to be for.
Thanks, Michael. All right, let's go on to some of the administrative questions on administering the Georgia Republican Party. We'll start with Michael Welsh with this question. Give some specifics in how you will raise money, and then specifically retire the state GOP staff.
Well, I've issued a plan. It's on my website. You can look at it. We address specific issues such as large dollar events. The very first one is in Savannah, not Atlanta. There are events that are specifically targeted to the rural folks, a dove hunt in South Georgia. There are events specifically targeted to the grassroots that can't afford a $250 plate grilling with the governor. There's events targeted to those that choose to play golf. Golfing at Oconee County. Folks, from top to bottom, I'm a planner. You can't get to some place if you don't know where you're going. Raising money is important. You gotta have a plan. Your plan's gotta be specific and it's gotta be executed. And that's what I have. Mike Welsh for GA.com has all the details.
Thanks, Mike. Alex Johnson, specifics of raising money and retiring the state GOP's debt.
Now, obviously, there's a lot to be done with raising money. There's doing events around the state. There's getting more people engaged. It's focusing not just on Atlanta. And all of that's been in my newsletters and publishing a plan on advance at GOP.com. The important thing to think about, though, is why would you give money? Like, what would cause you to want to give the state GOP or the RNC money? Like, think about that. Like, why do you give money to things? I know the reason why I give money is because I believe it'll make a difference, that it's going to a good use. And right now, that's what's missing. The state GOP is deeply in debt because of lawsuits, but not just a lawsuit. It's also in debt because if you look at some of the old disclosures on the FEC website, you'll see they're paying $1,000, $7,000 a month for communications consultants. There's someone from this county that was paid a lot of money, and no one seems to know what they were doing. Like, there are those type of jobs. Out of the state party. No one will give until people know where the money's going and for what purpose.
Michael, we need some specifics in how you'll raise money and specifically retire the state GOP's debt.
Well, just like we do in our own households, you don't spend more than you bring in. You have a budget. You prioritize based on what's important for you and your family. So in the state party, we have to have a budget. We have to say, we have an amount of debt, we have to have a plan for debt reduction. We have to have a vision for our party, because who is gonna write a check to the party when they don't understand
where the money's going, how it's being applied. So we need to do more than just say we need to raise money to defeat Democrats and get Republicans elected. But what does that really mean? What does it take to get Republicans elected? Why is that important? What does it take at all levels across our state? How do we spend this money? How are we saying that we're going to help local candidates buy signs or do phone banking or whatever it is? Talk specifically. Talk about a vision about engaging all communities. And when people hear a vision and they can buy into that, they'll give. And we do that at all levels, grassroots and at those that write the big checks.
John Watts is raising money and retiring to state GOP's debt.
Georgia Republican Party chairman is the fundraiser in chief, period. The reality is I uniquely stand before you as the only person who has been a professional fundraiser throughout my career, raising resources for men and women across this state to the tune of $25 million. To do so, we will have an integrated finance plan that makes certain we are looking at men and women that can contribute from $5 up to $250, $250,000, creating a regimented business plan, marketing plan, and having the dedication on a daily basis from a chairman that will be in the office, having the meetings, making the phone calls at breakfast, lunch, and dinner to make certain we are raising the resources. They don't give now. They, you in this room, and men and women across the state, don't give money now because we are not a value add. The party has stopped functioning as being a partner in this process, and that when we get again to being a value add, we will raise the resources.
Yeah. Our next question, we'll start with Alex Johnson. Your action plan to broaden the base of the party, what will you do to outreach to minorities and young voters?
Well, what's critical is having the entire state party staff and infrastructure focus on getting, on supporting county parties and getting people involved. It shouldn't be a top-down, like, oh, we're up here and you're down here. It's more, we need to be serving what the county parties need and want, in addition to providing training and sending out people into communities to build those relationships. The state GOP doesn't do events all over the state. There aren't advertisements going out. There aren't people being trained on this is how to build these relationships in communities that we currently don't have events going on in. We need to be in people's communities, talking to them, building relationships through that in order to possibly change and improve the party and bring in new people. Because if they don't know how our principles can help their lives or how the state GOP and the involvement in it can empower them into having a voice with politicians and in politics, they aren't going to want to be involved. We need to be there showing them how, by being Republican, it helps their lives, and how by being involved in the party, they can make an impact in politics.
The base of the Republican Party, especially the minorities and young voters.
We can't give this very important aspect of our party, we can't give it lip service. We've got to be doing it. I've had a history of doing that. I was the political director for the Georgia Young Republicans. I served as chairman of the Georgia Black Republican Council. And we have to go where people are. You can't just have one event and say, hey, we took some pictures and it all looked really nice. You have to build relationships. It's just like when I was dating my wife. Imagine if I'd asked her to marry me after one day. Wouldn't have gone so well. So I had to invest time and money over a period of time in order to get her to that point. We have to do the same thing regardless of the community, and we will see the success that we need to.
John Rochester, I changed the question to how will you woo minorities and young voters? Same question for you, John.
That's tough coming after that one. Good gracious. Good job, Michael. The reality is this. What I've committed to in terms of millennial engagement is this. I've said that I will create a panel of advisors from across this state that are indeed millennials. As a 48-year-old man, despite being a father of daughters 16 and 14, I need listen and be prepared as leader to reach out to folks and say, help me create the plan such a, I learn from you what the channels are of appropriate communication and how you read, discern, and figure out what it is to be a conservative. Once we then have a plan in place, we then can put the appropriate resources to it. In terms of engagement, we need engagement, embracement 24/7. We have, in too many situations as Republicans during election day, had members of the minority community stand up for photo ops and say, this is what we look like running up to the election. The reality is, look at this wonderful room today, a cross-section of age, demographic, components. This is Georgia, folks.
Thanks, John. Michael Welsh, the same question to you, outreach to minorities and young voters.
So appearances are deceiving sometimes. I'm the white-haired white guy, right? So you'd think I was the last person that would be the founder of the CSRA Minority Engagement Group, right? But you'd be wrong. Because I met with Jessica Hayes and we sat down and we came up with a plan and we put 200 minorities in a historically black college in Augusta, Georgia. I live with millennials. I have two that are still at home. I understand millennials. I have two that are married and have left home. I still get it from them. I am the state advisor for the Teenage Republicans. I get it from cradle to grave. I understand, and the policies and actions I take will ensure us to have a robust party.
Thanks, Mike. The Cobb GOP conducted an online poll on Facebook asking the questions, what's the biggest challenge facing our next Georgia GOP chairman? And in order from most to least votes, respondents cited number one, restoring confidence in the party. Number two, holding elected officials accountable to the party platform. Number three, raising funds to cover the current Georgia GOP deficit, growing the party base, keeping Georgia red. I want to back up to restoring confidence in the party. And this is a question that I hear very, very often. We use the word a lot today, but I want to hear how you would define it. And Michael McNeely, will begin with you. And take a second to think about this, because you guys don't know these questions in advance. How do you articulate what it means to be a conservative? How do you articulate what it means to be a conservative? We'll start the time when you start talking.
Well, I mentioned this earlier, it's about messaging. We talk very plainly, very clearly about what we believe, what our principles are, and then how they apply to people's lives. And you have to do that in a very simple way. It's not complicated. And a part of it, as I mentioned earlier, is about restoring a newsletter to our party, putting that information out there, talking about the successes that our elected officials, Republican elected officials, are having. I mentioned education reform, issues of taxation, and other issues where we've had successes. Because if you just talk principles, then people don't see the connection between that and policy. Then you work very closely with our Republican elected officials. So they're pushing initiatives that are very important and very conservative to us. We let our grassroots know and how they can be involved in that. We have to do that all year long. We have to do that with even the media that is often left-leaning. We have to communicate that message and so that people hear it time, day in and day out, and we get the job done.
Thank you, Mike. Okay. Restoring confidence in the party, number one in a Facebook poll. A lot of people think articulating a clear message is part of that. And John Watson, how do you articulate what it means to be a conservative?
We articulate a clear message, ladies and gentlemen, by not just talking the talk, but walking the walk. The reality is the men and women of our General Assembly, who I work with 3 months out of the year, are the voice of our elected official. They are our elected officials. And they go down there and they do yeoman's work, ladies and gentlemen, to promote the issues from across this state. And what we must understand and realize is that the men and women that go to the General Assembly, that promote our values, are the ones that we work to support on a daily basis. The role of the Georgia Republican Party is to support and be helpful in the communication of the process by communication, emails, newsletters, on and on and on, but the process must be ongoing. We must be reflective of who we are as a party to support our elected officials for limited government, freedom, freedom of religion, pro-Second Amendment, balanced budget, limited government, period.
Thank you. Michael Welch, how do you articulate what it means to be a conservative?
As an independent management consultant, I would be frequently hired to turn businesses around or fix things that were broken. And one of the first things that I would do is bring all the key stakeholders into a room and ask them certain questions about key things that they had in front of them, such as how do we clearly communicate conservatism, and then find out where we are. And invariably what we find out is that what everybody thought was known wasn't known at all. And that's exactly what's happened. We all know in our heads what conservative means. But if you ask somebody that's not part of the party proper, they'll have something different. And that different is being fed to them by a liberal media that has absolutely no love for us at all. And we are framed in a way that is very unfavorable. And we have to work doubly hard. Listen, a minister of a church does not replicate the base of his church one at a time. He goes out and says, you learn how to become a good minister to your community. And that's what we need. You need to be the biggest and best voice for conservatism for the Republican Party of Georgia.
Alex Johnson, articulating what it means to be conservative.
Right. And one thing that's important about the question, too, is that when you look at the idea that you have holding elected officials accountable is also something on that poll. And I think that it all comes together with articulating conservative principles, and that when elected officials do things that are positive and align with our principles, the state party has an obligation to make sure people know about it and how that's helping people's lives. One example, and many, some of you may not like it, some, most of you probably do, criminal justice reform is one example of something that was done by the legislature years ago. That was fiscally conservative, and it kept people out of jail, so it made it look as if, keeping families together. We all want to keep families together. We all want to save money, limited government principles. Republicans passed that. Democrats took credit for it. That's not what we need if we're going to be articulating how we're helping lives. But on the flip side, when we all pass resolutions and have a platform, that means that we don't go and say that we're supporting things such as higher taxes if we have resolutions against it. We stand for our principles, but that doesn't mean we have to attack the elected officials. That means we just make sure that everyone knows in the public how to contact their elected officials and have their voice heard. It's about empowering the people.
Thanks, Alex. Ladies and gentlemen, we've come to the end of the time that we have for questions. I'll let the candidates get their breath for just a second. We appreciate what you've heard here today. Thank you for being here and educating at least this part of the media about what you would do if you were elected. We sure appreciate you, and thanks for stepping forward to do this. We have 2 minutes for closing statements here, and that's about all the time we have left. And again, going in alphabetical order, so we agreed on the rules. Alex Johnson, you are first. 2 minutes, final pitch. Ask for the order.
Well, thank you all for having me here today. If you have more questions, you can contact me through advanceatgop.com, or I'll be around after for a while to talk to all of you. This election, what it really should come down to when you think about it is track record and credibility. And what I'd like for all of you to think about is that 4 years ago I ran for state party chairman. I wanted more people to be involved in the party. Ended up getting 40% of the vote but didn't win. So I started a grassroots newsletter. I sent things out to advanceatgop.com, keeping people informed, letting people know about events, and it's expanded over time to include more information. We talk about keeping cronyism out of the party and about millennials. I'm a 32-year-old attorney with my own legal practice that makes no money off politics. Completely, that's where I am. 2 years ago, I ran for chairman of the state party and thought about the financial difficulties of going to grassroots again. Got 45% of the vote, so instead of going away, I turned around and got involved to keep people involved through the Republican Assembly and showed people through those chapters how to be involved in the party, going from 6 people to over 170. I've led a statewide grassroots organization. I've been there keeping people informed and engaged. And you've seen that for years. And you can look back for the past 4 years of history on advancedgop.com. There's no hidden agendas. Nothing's hidden. It's transparency. And that's what we need if we're going to grow the party. That's what we need if we're going to raise money. That's what we need if we're going to keep Georgia red. Is we need a party that is serving you, not above you. We need a party that is committed to getting Republicans elected by growing our base, growing the number of people involved in the party, and actually using that to articulate our principles and multiply our efforts. You all are the leaders of the party.
It is my job to listen to you, believe in you, and have the state party do whatever's necessary to make it so more people are here following you, being trained, and getting more votes for Republicans. Because the demographic shifts in Georgia aren't a bad thing if we take advantage of them and talk to people and bring people over to our side and explain how we help their lives. Thank you all.
McNeely, your closing statement.
We need a chairman this principle. We've got to stand on our principles, and I've been willing to stand publicly on several issues that are important to Republicans. We need a chairman that has a long history of grassroots involvement, doing the fundamentals that we all do to help Republicans get elected and help grow our party. We need a chairman who understands engagement in all communities, has a history of that, has what it takes to go out and make sure that we build the necessary relationships so that our party grows and remains relevant to all communities and all people. We need a chairman that understands there's 159 counties in the state that everyone should be welcomed, respected, and listened to. And your ideas and your experiences should be incorporated into what we do. We cannot be successful without all of our fellow Republicans working hand in hand to get the job done. And we all can do this. We need a chairman who's going to be willing to get back to the basics. It's not about some fancy plan. It's about getting back to a budget and being transparent so everybody sees what we're doing and articulating how we're using money in our party, and we'll get people to come back. Those are the things that are important. Those are the things that I bring to the table to you, and I ask for your support to serve with you to grow our party and keep Georgia red.
Thank you, Cobb County. Thank you, Jason, Chairman Shepherd, for what your leadership. And Scott, you've got a great voice to go along with a good-looking face. And so you should be on TV. Ladies and gentlemen, as I said at the beginning, my pitch is simple. I stand before you as someone who for 25 years has been involved in this process on behalf of the party that I love. I've got the scars to prove it. I am by no means a perfect person. But the reality is, as you go to Augusta to discern the next leader, I would ask you to look at the times we are in. We are financially broken. We are mired in litigation. Our state party organization does not believe or understand answering the phone, let alone customer service. And the Democrats are indeed on the march and preparing for 2018 and the battle ahead. We must have a field general, a leader who can hit the ground running, who understands that the word I must be we face these challenges together. And that I, with the we's in this room, we'll take responsibility for the problems that we have, we will correct them together, and we will march forward to make certain folks, that 2018 yields yet another Republican governor for this great state. Thank you.
Thank you, John Watson. A closing statement from Michael Welsh. Mr. Welsh.
Well, first of all, I want to say thank you for giving up your Saturday morning to come hear the four of us speak. Because truthfully, on June 3rd, you will go to Augusta and you will choose the next leader of the Georgia Republican Party. And by default, you will set the direction for the coming 2 years that party will go. I have made clear over the course of this campaign my plans, my skills, my talents, and my abilities, and why they're so valuable to this party at this point in time, and what they will mean. You are exactly what the Founding Fathers wanted in an electorate. You are informed, you are educated, and obviously you're engaged. I want you to know that I will stand in front of you. I will stand in front of the governor of this state. I will stand in front of the largest donor this party has ever had. And every time, they will hear the same message and they will hear the same truth, because I am who I am and I will not change. we can move forward together. And I am humbly going to ask you for your vote and your support in Augusta, because together we can stand tall for Georgia and remain red for the foreseeable future. Thank you.
Thank you for your attention. I'll talk to you Monday morning on WSB Radio. They still swear they'll have the bridge fixed in 2.5 weeks, so we'll hold them to that. It was great visiting with you. Jason, some closing arguments here. You did a very good thing, putting this guy in front of the microphone in front of your podium. I'm not to be a political animal, but I'm a judge of character. This is a good man. Thank you, Jason.
But as a producer, you forgot to do the shameless plug for the Monica Matthews show also. Does everyone know Monica Matthews? She's actually one of our House District Secretaries. She's also on WSB every Sunday morning, 9 o'clock? 8 o'clock to 9 o'clock. So help support our folks that support us and are part of our organization. Thank you all once again. I think we have a lot of great options to choose from for chairman, and the Georgia Republican Party is going to be blessed to have one of you as its chair. Let's see, I always promise to get us out by 10. We got 11 minutes to that. And besides, none of you are going very far because, you know, I have to. You're all going to stay around and volunteer a bit, aren't you?
Yeah.
Not to put you on the spot, but one thing we do, everyone, Deborah, hold it up. On your table, there is a sign-in sheet. If we can get your name and information, just to let us know you're here. And so once again, we can bug you to come out and volunteer. And we appreciate you doing that. She's on the agenda. I'm not there yet. So, now time for announcements. First, let's start with candid one-minute speeches. If you are running for something other than state party chairman or for an elected office, I think we've already heard from a couple of them, but I also know we have a few other state party candidates in the room. Come up now, 1 minute, to tell us about your campaign, who you are, and what you're running for. Ms. Giles, are you still here? There you go, here she comes.
Thank you, Jason. Good morning.
Morning.
My name is Vivian Childs, and I'm running for first vice chair of the state GOP. This is the time right now when you've heard it from one of these men will be our next chairman. They need a first vice chairman who can hit the ground running, who has the experience, the knowledge, the contacts, the will, and the commitment to take this party forward. This is a hiring process, which means resumes do count. And the purpose of a resume is not to tell you what I'm going to do in the future, but to tell you and show you what I've already done. I have national experience, I have statewide experience, I have local experience. One of the best things is we talk about, show me one of the main things that you did. I was in a leadership position when we got rid of one of the biggest blue dogs, as they call them in the state of Georgia, and elected Austin Scott for 8th District. Congressman, I was there, I did those things. I would love to be your first vice. You can call me at VivianLChilds.com. But again, please, look at the resume, choose the one who will help whichever gentleman that you choose. Every voice matters. This is not a party of have and have nots. We're all in this together. Thank you very much.
And next up, Virginia Galloway, who wants to talk to you about giving away a trip to D.C. or something like that. Virginia is an old friend, former chairman of the Paulding County Republican Party. We go back probably 15, almost 20 years.
Yeah, we're not that old. You're not.
We used to not be.
That's right. Hi, good morning. I'm Virginia Galloway with Faith and Freedom Coalition. I want to invite each of you. This should be on your table. If not, you can grab one on the way out. Come to Washington, D.C. with us to our Road to Majority. It is going to be such an exciting time. This will be the first Road to Majority we've had since the Republicans were in charge. Yay! We have heard from a redheaded guy named Donald Trump that has been to our conference each year. We've invited him back, and we expect his attendance. It says invited speakers here. Almost all of these speakers have agreed to come. And we're going to do a drawing, but also I have had my arm twisted just a little bit by the chairman here. The person that volunteers the most hours for Karen and Kay in the next week will next Saturday win a trip for two to Washington, D.C., the bus package. Yes. Best deals ever. And not only do we have a bus package, we have a plane package this year. So, yes. Those people have ridden the bus before, like, yay! The bus is good too. Charter bus and plane. So, I'm going to ask, Mr. Slade, would you draw a winner from the folks? And did anybody not get to?
Yeah, we have some.
Okay, pass them up real quick. Okay, I think you got it.
This is the air one that we need to write your name on.
Chair for the Cobb County Young Republicans to make an announcement about the next Cobb County YR meeting.
Hi everybody, my name is Lisa Atkins and I am the Vice Chair for Membership for the Cobb YRs. Our next meeting is May 15th from 7 to 9 at the House of Blue right off of Marietta Square. We would like to invite all of you to come. The topic this month is our 11th Congressional District Chair, that's a mouthful. Brad Carver will be actually speaking and recapping President Trump's first 100 days. So again, we'd like to invite you all to come out and we hope to see you there.
As a former state chairman of the Georgia Young Republicans, I can't emphasize enough how much we have to support our young Republicans. I am now too old to be a young Republican, but I did pay for a life membership for the Cobb GOP years, Cobb YRs years back, and encourage as many people to come out as I can, and bring someone under the age of 40 if you know them. So, next up.
Excellent. Hi, my name is Lynn Murphy. I am here on behalf of the Cobb Carolyn Hall Fisher, who is also running for first vice chairman. Carolyn could not be here today because because she's in Carrollton, Georgia. She is the former head of the Forsyth GOP. She spoke at this breakfast last month. I went up to her afterward and got to know her a little bit better. And I'm going to tell you something. Anybody who was so ticked off at the way Obama treated Benjamin Netanyahu by allowing him to come in only the back door, and they were so mad, like Carolyn, that they actually called the Israeli Defense Force, went over there and fought side by side with them for a month. She is definitely worth you guys calling and checking out. Thank you for supporting Carolyn. May the 20th, Cherokee County Republican Party will have their first breakfast under the new executive committee at Cobb up in Canton, Georgia. We do have a table of Cherokee County folks over there with our vice chair of fundraising. So if you guys want to come, we've got two events going on, so plug that. And then one other thing, I have been to Virginia's events, and it is absolutely incredible. The Omni is wonderful. Her and Ralph Reed put on a terrific event. And I think that's it. Thank you.
Ed Setzler, our state representative from up in Atwood. I'm not going to steal his thunder on some great legislation that's signed. Ed Setzler, come up here and talk about it.
Still, Jason, we sometimes don't celebrate victories, and elections do have consequences, and I wanted to say a big thanks to our legislators. Something passed and was signed into law this week. After more than a decade of Republican control of the legislature, fighting in the House, the Senate, and committee, dueling things out in committee, overcoming vetoes, Governor Deal signed HB 280, which is the campus carry bill. And I just want to thank Representative Mandy Ballinger. She represents Cherokee County. And I want to thank all of you, because I think it's the pressure from grassroots and regular people. The idea of checking our constitutional rights at the border of campus is just unacceptable. And then when people walk on college campuses, they ought to carry their rights with them like they carry anywhere else. And I don't want to claim anything among Cobb legislators. I know all of our Cobb Republicans support that bill, but we don't celebrate our victories enough. And this is a long fought victory. Thank you.
Ladies and gentlemen, one more thing for me. If you want to hear how all of this sounded to our exciting, authentic, outspoken, new Christian conservative talk show host, Monica Matthews, be sure and listen tomorrow morning between 8 and 9 a.m. on WSB Radio.
All right, I think I got 1 minute to get through the final announcements. First off, I've been saying volunteers, volunteers, volunteers. One of the things we need volunteers for desperately, as well as door-to-door and phone calls, is sign waving at key intersections in K's district on Thursday, Friday, and then Monday and Tuesday, especially during rush hour, Tuesday morning. People usually don't come back to the polls. In the afternoon, they've started driving home from work at 5:30. Sometimes they'll get back to the polls. So we need people there in the morning. Daryl Wilson is the point person. Jerry Ramsey's already leading a team out there as well. But see Daryl, sign up, pick a time slot, and be there. We got to win this election. And we do not need the narrative a week from Wednesday morning being the Republicans couldn't even hold Senate District 32. How can they expect to hold Congressional District 6?
Use Facebook.
And get the message out via Facebook, social media. And also go to the new cobbgop.org. We have lots of information on there. If you haven't seen the new website, we launched it on Friday. Lots of resources there. Also, tomorrow from 3 to 5 p.m., Karen Handel is having a grand opening for her Cobb County campaign headquarters. The information is on the website. It was in your email inbox if you're on the Constant Contact email list. If you need the address, I'll read it once. It's near Lasseter High School. You come see me afterwards, I'll give it to you again. But it's 3750 Pavilion Village Drive, Suite 600, Marietta 30066. I know that was quick, but like I said, it's on the website with a link to the map. Finally, next Saturday, like I said, Volunteer Saturday. Burton Reeves, state representative, is one of our sponsors for this barbecue, along with Andy Soha and Bob Terrell. We are looking for more sponsors to help so we don't have to charge the volunteers. Their work is going to be what they get their pay their barbecue for. But be here next Saturday. We're looking to serve around 1 o'clock. We'll start sending folks out about 10 a.m. So it's really, when you have time, any time during the day, if you can give an hour, if you can give 2 hours, if you can give half a day, we need the help. Finally, we also have a fundraiser coming up in June. June 16th, that's a Friday. It's going to be at the new Braves Stadium, SunTrust Park. It is a reception with Taiwan's ambassador to the United States. We're doing this in conjunction with the Junior Taiwanese Atlanta Chamber of Commerce, so it's both an outreach. Okay. It's both an outreach and a fundraiser. You know, there was an article in the AJC about a couple days ago saying by 2020, Cobb County is going to be majority-minority. And we need to show up, we need to show that we are a partnership, especially with a group like the Taiwanese Junior Chamber of Commerce and others. The cost right now is $65 a ticket. It goes up to $100 a ticket. You get the meet and greet with the ambassador, and you get the ball game afterwards. So save the extra money, register now. I'll send out an email as well that's also already on the website. Finally, the final. If you show up on the first Saturday in June here, most of us are going to be in Augusta. You're welcome to have breakfast outside. I'm actually sure that there probably will be some folks here who didn't make it to Augusta, especially the RNC, doing phone calls. So there may be someone to let you in the door, but I'm not guaranteeing it. Also, Deborah Williams, stand up. Nothing. We need help with the 4th of July. If you want to help the 4th of July, see this woman. She's in charge of the float. She's in charge of the barbecue. She's got two committees and a lot of work. I'm not even beating her over the head about not volunteering because she's tied up with that, so she can use a lot of hands for it. And she can sit down there.
Pole watching.
Oh, and pole watching as well. Pam is in charge of finding pole watchers. If you can do poll watching, make sure the Democrats aren't cheating. See Pam, please stick around a little bit in volunteering, and I will set the motion to adjourn. Second. All those in favor? Let's get out here. Thanks for having me. Have a great day.